now we'll be turning our attention to our first panel of the day on economic opportunity then and now. If we can have the panelists join us. By now, many of you have noticed we very much have LBJ in the room with us, whether by his telephone tapes or through the photographs. And I just want to take a moment to say this is really thanks to the hard work of the LBJ Library and Museum. In recent months, we here at Roosevelt House benefited immensely from a tremendous partnership with our friends in Austin, and credit really goes to them for the archival material that have been setting the scene in you know, certainly last night, and now we have here today. So if you have a chance to have a chat with one of our friends from Austin, thank them. This has really, really added some texture that we're thrilled to provide, and we really just can't substitute for hearing LBJ in his very own words. I'd just like to draw your attention as we begin to talk about economic policy. I'm going to begin just showing you this slide of LBJ touring Appalachia. This is him meeting and speaking with people in West Virginia. Here we have President Johnson's 1964 State of the Union address, in which he declares unconditional war on poverty. Some would suggest there was really little political advantage in him doing so, and yet by engaging, poverty fell from 20% to 12% during his 5+ years in office. This was the largest one-time reduction of poverty in American history.
This administration, all Americans, to join with me in that effort. It will not be a short or easy struggle. No single weapon or strategy will suffice. But we shall not rest until that war is won. The richest nation on earth can afford to win it. We cannot afford to lose it.
Okay, as a nerdy economist, I'm going to readily admit my bias. Per Johnson and Galbraith, I happen to think this next panel is pretty hot, but I'm going to let you decide for yourselves. Moderating is none other than Dr. Corky Reimers, Professor Emeritus of Economics at both Hunter College and the Graduate Center of the City of New York. Students, and many of them are here in the room today with us, here at Hunter in the Public Policy Program, adore Corky and often refer to her street cred from the Council of Economic Advisors at the White House. We're really, really thrilled to have her moderating, and she's just been invaluable in helping us bring the symposium together. Corky is currently exploring the impact of the Great Recession on state and local government and its effects on public means-tested benefits, such as Medicaid. So we're really keen to see what she's able to share with us in the coming months. Joining us on the panel are a very dear friend from Cambridge, Richard Freeman, the Herbert S. Ascherman Professor of Economics at Harvard University. From the University of Wisconsin-Madison, Bob Haveman, a Professor Emeritus of Public Affairs and Economics and Research Associate at the Institute of Research on Poverty. Francis Fox Piven, Distinguished Professor of Political Science and Sociology at the CUNY Graduate Center, and a rising star from San Antonio. We're thrilled to welcome to New York Texas State Senator Ms. Leticia Van Putte. With that, Corky, I'm going to leave this in your capable hands.
Okay. Thank you, Terry, and welcome, everyone. It's a very hard act to follow the panel last night, I must say. I am not trying to be Bob Schieffer here, but I'll try to keep us somewhat on schedule so that we can get a lot of things talked about in the time we have and have some time at the end for questions from you. First of all, I think it's, I'm just astonished when I read about the sheer flood of legislation that LBJ was able to introduce and get passed. I think one history of the administration said 87 pieces of legislation were proposed and 84 were passed. An astonishing record when we think about where we are today. And among the, I'm not going to talk about the other programs that will be addressed by other panels, talking about the area of anti-poverty and economic opportunity. The number of programs in the War on Poverty, the Office of Economic Opportunities programs established by the Economic Opportunity Act, of Job Corps still in existence, the Neighborhood Youth Corps, VISTA, Model Cities, Upward Bound, Legal Services for the Poor. The Food Stamp Act of 1964 was also passed. Community action programs to organize the poor in their communities to make change. Head Start, still with us. And on and on. So first question I want to address to Professor Piven, the political scientist here, is why so many different programs? And who was proposing these different, so many different programs? And what were some, I'm interested in sort of what was behind the scenes, what were some of the conflicting perhaps, or competing at least, ideas of what should be done? How did we get to such a list?
Well, there was a flood of legislation, and it actually began under not under LBJ, but under John F. Kennedy, or at least the model for many of these legislative proposals was fashioned under the Kennedy regime. I have a somewhat different view on how we should try to assess presidents than others in this room. I think we have to assess them from, in a sense, the outside. They're not gonna tell us what they really intend. They're not gonna tell us their deepest secrets or their conspiratorial plans. We have to try to figure out what they do, why they do what they do, by treating them, I think, as politicians. And politician is not a bad word. It's not an insult to say that someone gets to be president by being politically alert, ambitious, skilled, and so on. That means that this person tries to deal with the popular currents in the society that affect voting majorities and affect the way interest groups behave, and tries to ride the currents of both popular opinion and interest group activity. I think it's impossible to give a coherent explanation of the Great Society without paying attention to the Black Freedom Movement. And I think we're trying hard to do that, but that's a mistake. The Black Freedom Movement, which itself was thrust up by the huge migration of African Americans from the South to the northern cities and the tumult in the northern cities that resulted from racial conflict in the cities and from riots in the cities. These problems had to be dealt with by a democratic regime, whether it was JFK or LBJ. And I think the underlying explanation for why we had so many programs directed to the poor, often directed to the urban poor, and often programs that limited the constraints that state and local government could put on the implementation of those programs, the ultimate answer has to do with these convulsive changes that were occurring in the society and the efforts of a democratic national regime to ride those changes, to cope with those changes. So I think that whatever the rhetoric that is attached to each program, and the rhetoric about under JFK, juvenile delinquency and youth crime, or the rhetoric about community mental health, or the later rhetoric about the war on poverty, blighted cities, and so on, that these programs were a political intervention in the federal system and in our social policies intended to try to integrate, calm, soothe the Black freedom movement, especially in its rougher expressions in the cities.
Thank you. Does any of the panel have another point to make or some comment on Professor Piven's viewpoint? Yes.
Thank you very much, and it's my honor to be here today, especially at the Roosevelt House. I'm a state senator in San Antonio and a pharmacist by profession. My grandfather had a botica, La Botica Guadalupana, and that was in, if you've ever been to San Antonio, it's now in the Mercado, in the Market Square. The picture that, as you entered that drugstore, was a huge, like a 2-foot by 3-foot picture of President Roosevelt, and then next to it, as just as big, his NRA number for that drugstore. And we have to remind students that's not National Rifle Association, that's the National Recovery Act. And even under threat of that they asked Grandpa to take it down because it was no longer law, he refused. And they came and they said, you have to take it down. Well, he refused. And that picture and that NRA certificate stayed up there until the pharmacy was closed in 1988. But what those programs meant were not just words on paper. They weren't just rights, or as like my grandmother used to say, who never really spoke English very well, she said it was no de los derechos hasta que están hechos. In other words, your rights, your derechos, aren't really rights until they're hechos, until they're made, until they're action. And so what I saw visibly during that time frame was the opening of the Texas Welfare Office. And it was the first opening of that office right there at the corner of Santa Rosa and Produce Row, right across the street from that pharmacy. The day that the applications, you could go to get the applications for food stamps, we got to the pharmacy, at least my grandpa got to the pharmacy about 7:30, 7:45 in the morning. And there were lines 2 blocks long just to get that application. And so it was not just what the words, it was the promise of you could feed your children, you can get some childcare. It was not just about the poverty, it was about the chance of living a life of dignity. And for me, it was seeing for the first time someone look at Mexican Americans differently. And I think most of what we look at in the civil rights and in economic is about the struggle of African Americans. Well, in the Southwest, it applied to Mexican Americans, Latinos, who absolutely loved LBJ because the opportunity meant we too could live a life of dignity and we could graduate from high school and people could go to college. And I think particularly for women, the fact that you could have maybe some childcare and Head Start meant that you might be able to actually get into the workforce to help your family. So for me to see that firsthand, it was absolutely fabulous. And I've got to tell you, I'm fearful, because what I see at this very time when our nation needs it the most is a total assault on the type of programs. And the victimization of people who are poor, like it's their fault to begin with, very, very different from what FDR and what LBJ really stood for, is that, sure, okay, we're from Texas, and yeah, we have a little bit of you pull yourself up from your own bootstraps. But what they didn't understand that LBJ always understood is that we knew when neighbor needed to help neighbor. And that's what I'm fearful that we have forgotten.
Thank you. That opens up the question of the opening of opportunity by the War on Poverty programs and the other Johnson administration programs. And so I wanted to ask Professor Haveman, what opening up opportunity is one prong, you might say, of the program. Others are giving people the ability to use opportunity, and others are just giving them money. But let's start with opening up opportunity, which does, of course, cover civil rights, but I'm more interested in the economic opportunity programs and what you think are the limitations. How much can you accomplish by just opening up opportunity, if we could open up even more than we have?
Corky, thanks. I'd like to thank the sponsors of this wonderful event for the opportunity to be here. The question you pose, big question. We've heard a lot of talk about the plethora of legislation that LBJ was able to get on the books. A remarkable period. Government had a wonderful go at equalizing opportunity. It had a wonderful go at providing support of various kinds to black people, to poor people, to the disenfranchised. Let me give you a couple of statistics. At the time that the Brown decision was issued, in this country, governments were spending $300 per person on assisting low-income families through cash-like provision. That's $300. Today, in this country, we're spending per capita, constant dollars, $3,000 per capita. Government has not shirked in its efforts to provide a hand up to those at the bottom. And those programs say nothing about the many housing, education programs, job training programs, the billions of dollars we spent on enforcement, monitoring, and litigation to enforce affirmative action. If you then say, well, what has been accomplished? Have we really made big strides in opening up opportunity? The answer is not so much. So if I take the ratio of black male earnings to white male earnings, in the late 60s, it was about a 70% ratio. It's climbed a little bit. It's now at about a 78% ratio. Not a lot of progress. If you take income of blacks versus whites, in the late 60s, it was at about 50%. It's now about 60%. Some progress, not a ton. If you take test scores of students in school, we had a remarkable period from the 60s through the 80s in which the test score gap between blacks and whites fell. Since the 80s, it's been pretty much stagnant. If you take a look at school segregation, because of court rulings forbidding dual schools, school segregation by any measure fell substantially in the 70s and 80s. At the beginning of the 1990s, that had stagnated. And the evidence, and there are increasing numbers of scholars looking at this, is it's apparent that we are gaining resegregation of public schools, especially in the South in this country, in which the percent of black students that are attending schools that are 90 to 100% populated by other black students, that indicator is in fact rising. In corporate America, 1% of the senior corporate positions in the top 1,000 firms are occupied by black people. On corporate boards, 3% by black people, 2% by Hispanic people. The only real place where poor black Hispanic people have had the gates open to them is the nation's penal system. At the time that the Brown decision was signed, there were 98,000 black people in the nation's prisons. Today, there are 850,000 black people in the nation's prisons. That's a ninefold increase. 40% of black men who are high school dropouts are sitting in the jailhouse today. So the progress, given the good go, Corky, has been spotty. And it's hard to look out and say, yes, opportunities for poor and black people have really expanded in these last 50 years. Let me just conclude the points I want to make here by saying that there are good reasons for this. Government had to be swimming upstream during this period. The world became a global economy. Jobs that provided employment and steady employment for people with modest skills in the manufacturing sector went overseas. The labor market, and I'm sure Richard will talk about this more than I, has shown a propensity to spread the gap between the lowest earners and the very highest earners, spread that gap in a remarkable way in the last 30 years. Family structure has eroded, especially family structure in the black family. At the same time, most of our schools were making progress in educating students. Inner city schools didn't change much at all. It's tough to make progress in equalizing opportunity when you're swimming up against that stream.
Professor Freeman, the labor economist here, looking at the labor market and thinking about what the aim of the Johnson programs was, really to give workers skills, training, not opening up opportunity, but also changing the poor low-wage workers so that they could earn more in the labor market. What do you see as the pros and cons if you were revisiting that decision to go for skills training rather than just income maintenance, cash benefits? Would you do it differently if you could, if you were LBJ?
Yeah, well, I would start. I wouldn't be as negative as Bob has been for the following reason. The notion that in Washington you're going to pass some laws and you're going to cure poverty in the country and change the country within our lifetime is extremely idealistic and expects too much. I don't know how much actually the Johnson administration thought they were going to accomplish, but you get yourself moving down a road, and I keep thinking of the Chinese leaders, you know, say take a step, take a step, take a step, and then you can do things. If we take the poverty, we're now at about 16% poverty, which is higher than the number given right at the end of the boom of the 60s. About half of that poverty, I would say, is incurable on the basis of any skill, removal of discrimination for workers and so on. There are people in the society who are disabled, who have all kinds of ailments, mentally retarded people, so on. Every society has a chunk of people like this, and you cannot get them out of poverty by work, et cetera. So I would have thought the minimal we might have gotten the poverty rate through the most successful jobs, you know, raise the minimum wages, do all kinds of things like that. Maybe you can get it to 8%. That's, you know, it could be 7, it could be 9, but it's in that ballpark. The other people you have got to give a serious handout to. If you're going to have a work program for people who are mentally retarded, you can do that. Some countries actually put taxes on every business, which then goes to a fund so they can pay special manufacturing or special places. And those people are paid a decent wage, but they have to be supplemented. So there has to be that. And I thought that was missing in the rhetoric of the administration, and it may have been right, obviously, political thing to do, But that's the most you could possibly get, is to that level. And the countries that do better than we do on poverty, and I think of the Nordic countries, they have very extensive programs for the people who fall below the ability line. So that's one. Then the changes that we saw in these wage differentials and in employment things, yes, they're not a full glass. But it was pretty empty beforehand. And so I think the right way to think of this is not as it was going to cure in the limited term that LBJ, term and a half, or you take it as the LBJ and go back to JFK, the two terms that was there to cure poverty in the country or remove all these things. So there were steps forward. I think there were steps, I'll phrase it this way, incorrect. I'm sure everyone has a list of things they thought were wrong. You said there were 83 laws at the 83 of 87, and I thought it was 100 of 87 got passed. There were so many things going on that when you look back at this, you say, oh, there was this. My impression was the ones that were directly aimed at poverty didn't do so great at all. Some of the other laws, be it the Voting Rights Act, Civil Rights Act, other things did have an effect. Opening up the higher education, there was a whole set of, so it may be that the whole scatter, this huge approach, ultimately had greater effects, but you still sort of sit there and say it left a lot of opening for people who opposed to say this thing failed, this one hasn't worked, et cetera. That's an interesting political decision not to have pushed, you know, one or two signature things forward. Well, I don't know presidents of the United States. I know presidents of universities. Usually you say to the president of a university, you have one or two things you can do, and then the faculty is going to just eat up everything the way the Congress maybe does, and you better just figure out what it is you want to do with those one or two things. And you do those, and then maybe you get out in 4 or 5 years and let the next president come and do one or two things. This was an extraordinary thing to across the boards, et cetera, and I think that's the key way of thinking about it, was such a massive effort in such a short period the right strategy? Has it succeeded in some levels? I think it has, and places it hasn't.
Reactions? Did they try to do too much and oversell and therefore generate disappointment and sort of giving up? Or did you get more in the end because you tried to do so much? I mean, where do you think it comes out? Have we lost more because they oversold, or have we gained more than we would have gained if they hadn't?
Let me just pick up a Professor moment Haveman. on Richard's notion of what happens in a university when a president tries to make policy. He didn't use the word backlash, but he could have used the word backlash. To me, what we're observing in this country today is something like backlash. Mm-hmm. Americans seem to have lost their taste for an activist government. One of the most discouraging polls is the Pew poll on the extent to which Americans today support affirmative action in employment, promotion, and higher education. Around 2/3 of Americans oppose affirmative action. The rise of the Tea Party is a very thinly disguised effort to get the government out of the business of helping people. It's a position that the holders of it, I can't get my head around. These are programs that support them and help them become part of this polity. It's screwy, in my view, that it's this group that ought to be the biggest advocates for the public sector getting out of the business. But I think that making policy today in the areas that Richard was talking about and doing it step by step is trying to make policy in an environment which is extraordinarily different and extraordinarily difficult to make policy in this area, frankly.
Professor Piven?
Well, I do want to comment on this, yeah, because I don't think that the periods of reform in American politics and policy have in fact been step-by-step periods. They've been rather explosive periods. The legislative initiatives of the Progressive Era, for example, which reflected the agitation of the populist movement and the labor agitations of the turn of the 20th century, these were not step-by-step initiatives. The New Deal initiatives, which, you know, it's part of our agenda, right? We're supposed to be looking at FDR to LBJ. The New Deal was not a step-by-step set of policy initiatives, experiments, or reforms. It was rather a burgeoning and explosion of such reforms in response to the social movements that were sweeping through the country. Just as I think the Great Society initiatives were a response to a great social movement that was sweeping through the country. I'd like to make one other point in this regard. Often the consequences of a policy initiative are not evident from looking only at the consequences of the changes that the policy professes to undertake. They're rather indirect. So that, you know, it's ambiguous what the consequences of the war on poverty were. But the increase in per person expenditures on the poor from $300 to $3,000, that occurred significantly through cash assistance programs. And the cash assistance programs were not named, were not really explicitly targeted in the panoply of legislative initiatives called the Great Society. Rather, an indirect consequence of making resources available in the poorest neighborhoods of the country, thousands of legal service attorneys, for example, an indirect consequence was that the welfare rolls, the food stamp rolls, they expanded. And that did have an impact on poverty, a very significant impact on poverty. And yes, of course, there is a backlash, but that's politics too. And I mean, it's part of what we have to consider when we consider the possibility of egalitarian reform.
Senator Van de Putte, how does it look from Texas and where you sit?
Looking back over it and as a policymaker today, the actions and the results were cumulative. I do not really believe that you can look at just the economic or one, either Head Start or food stamp, and not take into account what it meant for representative democracy to have the Voting Rights Act and the Civil Rights Act. Because people in poverty, and particularly people of color, the ability to elect the candidate of their choice who then sits on a policy body that can vote made a huge difference in making sure that the acts were real and that the programs got real. Because most of the programs, you know, some of the federal programs were a total federal allocation. Most of them, though, were required some sort of state or local match or implementation or administrative fees. So it was this real concept of federalism that was embedded in a lot of the programs. But when you look at particularly the Voting Rights Act, and just wanted to let you know, for those of you who did not know, yesterday at 4:45 p.m., which would have been about 5:45 this time, Texas is in a redistricting case. Texas is a fast-growing state. We added 4 new congressional districts, and anytime you do that, there's a lot of discussion on how you should draw the lines. About 80% of the population growth in Texas in the last decade was due to minority population growth. However, we are a Republican-controlled legislature, so you wouldn't be surprised to know that 75% of the 3 of the 4 new congressional seats were actually added were Republican seats. So we're in court, and yesterday, the Attorney General filed amended proceedings. And in that amended proceeding is not just the small little reference to Section 5 of the Voting Act, but a full assault on the, and he is pleading that Section 5 is unconstitutional, both from the 10th Amendment and from other bases. Because we know that this has been coming, but if you look at where we are in the queue, our fear, realistically, is this could be the case that gets to the current Supreme Court first, and at real risk is that absolute Section 5 of the Voting Rights Act. So I'm telling you, I think we're in a hostile environment. Well, the laws of physics are that for every action, there's an opposite and equal reaction. Those programs that were done 40 and 50 years ago. I believe that it has taken probably the full amount of that, because it isn't until folks get in tough economic times again that they want to find somebody or something to blame it on. And so I think what you're seeing now, particularly with the anti-immigrant rhetoric, is some sort of let's blame it on someone or something. And I've got to mention this because, you know, demographics are our destiny. We have 60,000 Hispanics who turn 18 every month. Every month. My city of San Antonio is a majority Latino city, a majority minority city. Looks like what the state of Texas will look like probably in the next 6-7 years. And we look like what the United States is going to look like in about 30 years. So the challenge before us, I think, when we look at the different programs, is that FDR, LBJ knew what they really needed to do, and they were focused and strategic on it. And yeah, maybe they used a birdshot approach that just throw everything out there. But I think that unless we really look at the changing demographics, the educational disparity, the poverty disparity, then we're really at risk. But I don't think you can point at one program. I think it was the cumulative effort, and I can't tell you that I don't think the economic part would have worked without the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act.
Thank you. Well, the change in the economic environment that you mentioned, that it was a period in the 60s where we had been growing, expanding, prosperous. People felt they were going to get better off and make other people better off at the same time. And then you alluded to the environment now where people are feeling, you know, things have turned down and they're looking for somebody to blame. And also there just isn't as much growth to spread around. And I looked at the poverty trends since 1959 when they started compiling the statistics. You see this huge drop between 1959. It had already dropped by about 6 percentage points by 1964. It had dropped another 5 or 6 points by 1969-72. And then remember what happened in 1973? We had the oil shocks, we had stagflation, and pretty much ever since then, you see the poverty rate go up in a recession and down again in the subsequent expansion, and then up again and then down again. You do not see a continuing downtrend, except for one group of people, which is the elderly. Their poverty rate plummeted in the 60s and has stayed down, and in fact, today is lower than it's ever been, 9%. This sounds like, you know, give people enough cash and they're not counted as poor. So what that brings me to wonder is whether anti-poverty programs as such can, or labor market programs even, other than trying to get a growing economy and expanding labor market that pulls people into the workforce who otherwise may not be the most skilled, desirable workers, but get pulled in and wages are pulled up, whether that is actually the best anti-poverty strategy nowadays. So maybe Professor Freeman or anyone else who wants to comment on that, and then after the panel has a chance, we can open to questions from the audience. Just a minute.
Yeah. The evidence we have is from the 1990s boom, and that was the closest we've ever gotten to really full employment, or we were at really full employment. And the poverty went down. Real wages rose for people at the bottom of the earnings distribution. Less skilled people had increases in wages. You saw signs on stores, if you'll remember, all around looking for clerks and people to come and work. And that was around 8-9%. That was a 10%, depending on whether you look at persons or families, a poverty rate. So, yeah, you clearly can get to a low level. Now, the notion, one thing I disagree with you, we're not poorer than we were in the 1960s. Our total production per person in this country is twice as high. It's much, much bigger. The key thing to understand is that all of the gains of productivity over the last 30 to 40 years have gone to a small number of people. The protesters in New York said the upper 1%, and they were wrong. It's the upper 0.1%. That's where we live in a society. And so it isn't that we're poorer. This country is wealthier than it was under Johnson, certainly wealthier than it was in FDR's period. And the wealth has just all gone to an extremely small number of people. And somehow or other, some of us regard these people as the great job creators. Well, there's not full employment. They haven't done it. And the last time we had, you know, full employment was basically the 90s boom. And that was not that the billionaires were going out and hiring lots of people and so on. That was more macroeconomic policy. The government played a significant role in that. And so it's not true that we're so poor today that we can't afford the programs that we had 30 or 40 years ago.
Professor Haveman.
Yeah, let me just pick up on Richard's point here. The growing inequality, especially at the top, is shocking. But to me, equally shocking is a development that will make Lucy Baines' father and mother turn over in their graves. To me, it's the willingness of Americans to accept this growing corporate and this growing right-wing power, economic power, to be legitimate forces in the direction of public policy in this country. The efforts to water down affirmative action efforts, the efforts to counter collective bargaining and the strength of unions, the efforts to erode voting rights in this country, the efforts to dilute the progress we've made in women's health, are being orchestrated by a group of people who are the people that Richard spoke about, the 0.1% in the society who have made bazillions of dollars and now intend to direct it to goals that I would view as in direct opposition to those that motivated policymaking in the mid-60s. And that's a danger that I think that any political leader must confront today. And I must say I'm depressed and don't see a way out of it easily either.
Professor Piven, are you depressed?
I would just like to comment on the suggestion here at the panel that there has been a huge backlash, and presumably that has gripped a majority of the American people, of American voters. I don't think it serves us well to exaggerate the reactionary tendencies of the American public. It is true, as Robert said, that we have well-heeled political operatives at work who do amplify the sentiments of the Tea Party movement. But the Tea Party movement is definitely a minority movement. About 20% of the population is sympathetic with Tea Party positions. That 20% is overwhelmingly white. It is pretty old, older certainly than the general population. It's better off than the general population. Moreover, even at the most glorious moments of American populism, we have had right-wing movements. The right has always been with us. In the 1930s, when, you know, in our sort of romanticism with the 30s, we imagine a great labor movement marching side by side with the unemployed and so forth. We also had Father Coughlin and his huge radio audience. And so in the aftermath of the Great Society, we have had the Birchers, the Patriots, the Militia, and now the Tea Party. They're part of America. There's always been the last century, there's been a strong minority that has reacted against the changes that you and I would consider to be progressive changes, that has reacted against an African-American president, that has reacted against the browning of the general population, that has reacted against the emancipatory sexual changes that have taken place in the society. They're with us. But what's happened now is not that a majority of Americans has turned against the ideals of the New Deal or the Great Society, but rather that minority of Americans has been harnessed and their sentiments amplified by big money that needs a populist base. They need to be able to speak for people. They can't just speak for the bankers. Well, they in fact do just speak for the bankers, but they have to appear to have a populist base.
In New York, the bankers are very important, remember.
So that's true, but Richard, we've never gotten anywhere by relying on the bankers.
I wanted to comment was that the best anti-poverty program that you have in any little city, in any rural community, is a quality public education. And so with the start of that program called Head Start, LBJ FDR realized that there are children who enter school not as prepared. And so the concept that a quality early childhood education could help jumpstart that, affirmative action. And so the equalization and resources, so it didn't matter what zip code you lived in, is if you have about the same equity of resources, if we can get the best teachers in the hardest to staff campuses. Given that, it should not be any surprise that we're not there yet, and that we're going to continue. But, I'm maybe on the personal side, I'm always kind of a cup full girl, grandchildren, a great legislative life. But on the public side, I tend to be the cup half empty girl. And what I'd like to really understand in this is that I don't think all of our businesses are really excited about what is happening and the support of the right. Because what I hear from businesses is if we do not have the workforce and the quality of life, then we don't have the capacity of citizens to be able to buy the goods and services that they want to sell us. So what I hear from some of the business community is that they're very concerned about what they hear from the banking community. But if you talk to retailers, if you talk to the tech community, if you talk to other sectors of our economy, they are really worried, because if you have a diminishment of a per capita income, and I'm no economist like you professors, but all I know is that if you don't have a great education system, you don't have students and folks that can be hired in a workforce, they don't have the capacity to buy goods and services. And so it's incumbent on business, not because it's the right thing to do, but because it's an enlightened self-interest. So maybe I'm not so worried, and maybe you've got kind of a different view here in New York with a lot of the banking community.
Well, thank you, and let me open it up now for questions from the audience to the panel. We have about,
15
minutes?
I would suggest to the panel that one of the great reports of the Great Society is Medicare and Medicaid.
Get the mic so everyone can
hear. I was going to suggest to the panel that one of the great cornerstones of the Great Society is Medicare and Medicaid, and one of the reasons probably that the elderly poverty rate is so low is because they are now relying on Medicare and Medicaid. And also, the Pulitzer Prize winner just next to me suggested also the indexation of Social Security was also critically important in terms of poverty.
Yeah, particularly the latter. Yes, could you all identify yourselves when you ask a question, and please ask questions and try to keep them brief so that everybody gets a chance.
I think he did ask a question with that. As a pharmacist and still practicing pharmacist, I can tell you that on Medicaid and Medicare, particularly on Medicare, the addition of Medicare Part D, the prescription drug benefit, really has helped. And that was just recently. But you know, before that, I work at a pharmacy in the barrio. Title I school, this is a zip code that has the highest number of teen pregnancy, highest number of dropouts, highest number of juvenile justice referrals, lowest number of home ownership. You know the community that, you know, could be dotted in every community in any state. But when folks are not put at risk in financial ruin because they've got an access to go see a doctor, or particularly to get prescription drugs, has made a tremendous difference.
And stand up as well as identify yourself.
Yeah, I'm Howard Chernick from Economics here at Hunter, and I just wanted to react a little bit to Senator Vanderputt's observation about matching rates, which happens to be an area that I've worked in a lot. And one, it's interesting in retrospect that Medicaid, the country bought into Medicaid as a shared financing with a lot of federal money, but a lot of state money. And one way of viewing the history of American federalism is that the state's willingness to cooperate has successively been reduced. So CHIP took a greater federal share than Medicaid. And when we got to the Obama health insurance plan, a place like Louisiana said 90% is not enough. So in a way, that kind of cooperative federalism has diminished or been evaporated. And it kind of fits with the comments last night about Lyndon Johnson bringing in different parties from all over, the key players who, of course, represent different states and that. So just a comment, which I'd be interested in any reactions.
I think you said it. Exactly. I feel that is happening, where I got to tell you, women are mad. Women are really angry. And one in particular is the women's health program. Thank you, ladies. The women's health program, talk about a great program. It's a 9-to-1 match. So for every dollar that the states put in, feds put in 9. This is family planning money. This gives women the ability to plan their preconception, plan their families, and be able to have those choices. Women are angry because the rhetoric out there, and I think that's going to backfire. I think women are really going to show up at the polls on this. When somebody can say in a presidential campaign, well, birth control is aspirin between your knees, I thought we fought that 40 years ago, ladies. This is something that, as we see states not willing to put as much money in, I think our national focus is on the presidential, on the congressional. When it comes to healthcare programs, and economic programs, and workforce training, folks, the people that you elect at your state legislatures, those are the folks that are saying yay or nay to the dollars that match. And increasingly, we're seeing states say, no, I don't think so, because the people in control at state legislatures have this view of, well, it's a mandate from the federal government. But you're right on point on the Medicaid side.
You want to stand up and identify yourself? Thank you.
My comment actually starts out with Richard's observation at one point that some of the poor would always be with us, that something like 8% cannot earn their way out of poverty. But my comment really is, do you think that we can actually adequately measure poverty? That one of the odd situations we're in now is that we measure poverty in a way that is really pre-transfer, many of the programs that were passed under the war on poverty. And so all of you are sort of burdened when you talk about poverty by our not having an index that would really capture the effect of something like food stamps, which as you were, was described as, you know, people really have a high take-up rate of food stamps. And so there are a whole set of programs. And so when we talk about it and think about the legacy, isn't it important to be able to adequately measure the contribution of whether it's Medicaid or food stamps or some of the housing programs on the economic well-being and to really capture adequately poverty?
Any comments or further comments about the measurement? That is bringing up a very good point that when we all think of Medicaid and food stamps as some of the most helpful programs, and actually those don't help reduce the measured poverty rate, because the way the poverty rate is measured is whether your cash income is above the poverty line.
Well, that's so true, but we also use a poverty line that is reflects very ancient beliefs. We measure poverty by the cost of a food basket of basic foodstuffs, I guess pork, liver, and cabbage, and we multiply that by 3 and don't take into account either greater inflation of some of the other costs of living, and we don't take into account such costs that the modern family has to bear as the cost of childcare in the United States. So I agree that we don't have an adequate measure of poverty in the United States, but I would not want to leave the implication that we measure poverty in a way that overstates the extent of poverty in the U.S. To the contrary, poverty has increased over the last decade as best we can tell, and extreme poverty has increased a lot, and that, of course, is scandalous.
There are multiple measures,
yes,
and the National Academy of Sciences produces them, and the BLS produces them. So we could, the same way they do with the unemployment rate, you give you U1, U2, U3, they go a whole bunch. You can look at all of them, and as they all show the same trend. So when you make adjustments, it's still the direction. We've got this ancient thing which Molly Urshansky invented X years ago. The latest report from the census, they were talking a lot about near poor people. People who were just a bit above the poverty line. And of course, you can look at people far, far below. It's just a crude number meant to, you know, capture attention. And we certainly could change it if we wanted to. But I think anyone who's, and I'm sure this is true inside the government as well as in the academic world, if you're really worried about poverty, you have a whole bunch of measures in front of you, and you know we understand it's different if you're hungry and homeless than if you're just, you know, barely below the poverty line but have a place to live in and so on and so forth. So I think we can do better with the measures, but it'd have to be a sell. Some politician or someone would have to go and say, "Here's the better measure. Let's forget the old one." And that I think is pretty hard to do, and so as long as they all track together, at least we get the trends right.
Yes, I see a few hands back here. Let's see. You, sir, and then we can take the one behind you.
My name is Irvin Duggan, and I have a question for reaction from the panel about backlash. It seems to me that we have had a sort of shift of the tectonic plates from the days of FDR and LBJ from retail politics to wholesale politics, in which the technology of politics, the mastery of the amplifier, has become much more important, and that money has a disproportionate impact. The tiny minority of the Tea Party have a disproportionate economic ability to seize the media, to have a network that speaks for one policy, for one party, to seize the amplifier and buy airtime. And it seems to me this is a very serious shift in the debate. Instead of a kind of equal playing field, we now have a situation in which money is much more likely to buy political success. It makes me pessimistic, and I wonder what the comments of the panel are about financing the backlash, even though it represents a small minority.
Well, since I'm the only one up here with a campaign account, I can tell you it's egregious, the amount of money that we have to keep. And I'm just a state senator, but our districts in Texas are about 880,000 folks, so larger than the congressional district. So most of us keep over $1 million in our bank accounts, our campaign accounts. Now, that's going to sound awful, and it is, but understand it's way larger than a congressional district. Challenging even at our level, it costs $3 to $4 million to run a race, and that's because you can't use one mail out to is like $75,000, so you have to use media. What I think that the right has been very, very adept at is using the blogosphere, and that has been well documented. They were the first out, even though I would like to call the moral justice, the social justice folks out there on the blogosphere. The Tea Party, my colleagues on the Republican side are not as fearful as of the money being cut off. They're fearful of the blogosphere. Somebody sitting at home in their pajamas who has access to voting records and all sorts of stuff, and it just spreads virally. We have not done, and I say we in a more progressive sense, have not been out there as long on those types of technologies. And the folks that we represent and support us may not always have access to that either. And so we're using more of Twitter and hashtags. Where I think we do, where it's going, is where most stuff is controlled by the internet or by emails. People in poverty don't have access, but guess what they do have access to? What we have found, a lot of them have access to those little cell phones. And that's where Twitter, on the technology side, with their little 140 characters, where we're picking up. What they have found is that that's, you may not have access to email because you don't have a computer at home, but anybody can text and anybody can sign up on that. And so that we have to find mechanisms to get to folks who would be supportive and to get them engaged. Latinos in record numbers go out to the poll, and if they vote their family, and women if they vote their health care, I think that you may see a shift at some of the state legislative races, which may then impact budget decisions made. But we've got to ensure that the folk, that it's not just about the money, and the only way you can combat that is to figure out technology that is usable by folks that don't just, you know, get to have internet at their home.
Yeah, could I think maybe we'll just have to wind it up after your comment, because we need to move to the next.
You know, let me address directly your point. In my view, one of the most serious facilitators of this trend that you mentioned is the Supreme Court's Citizen United decision. we would not see the virility of this today if it weren't for that decision. And if Michael Beschloss is still here or there are other legal historians here, I would just like to hear a word about how the Supreme Court might in the future be able to pull back from this decision, which to me at least looks very difficult to pull back from. I think until you find a way, and Michael was very optimistic about the long run ability of this polity to right itself. If you're going to right itself, the court has in some way got to be pulling back from this decision. And I don't understand how.
I would say this is probably great fodder for us to continue the conversation over a short break. So thank you so much to our panel, Corky, Richard, Leticia, Bob, and Fran. Thank you so much. We're going to take a brief 10-minute